of you know somebody that you believe would fit the criteria of the word peculiar? Come on, this is your moment. If they're sitting by you, you can raise your hand and they think you're talking about somebody else. So, right? So we all know somebody that we think are peculiar. So, you know them. They're in your family. They're in your school. They're in your neighborhood. They're married to you. They're your coworker. They're all over the place, right? Peculiar. Here, you know, the thing about, let me say this first, about peculiar is that everybody's definition of peculiar is going to be different from somebody else's, right? Watch this. This is pretty peculiar. Here's an example.
Something a burglar would not want to see when he breaks into a house.
Naked grandma!
Naked, huh? I don't want to see that either. I know you're right, okay? Nobody wants to see a naked grandma, but what are the chances of you breaking in the house and running up in your grandmama naked? Looking for a naked grandmama in the house, outside, in the woods, on the blanket. That's the occupant person that's there.
Hey, that's your pastor. You go to the Naked Grandma Church. You didn't know that. By the way, you're welcome, everyone, for the beard, because I had him grow that, so. You know, that would be peculiar, right? By the way, if you know we were on Family Feud several times, and you want to do yourself a favor and look up Spiegel Family, you do it where? I'm just going to leave that right there because there's kids in here, but you need to go back and watch that, okay? Some of y'all are literally pulling your phones out and putting that in your phone right now. Spiegel Family, you do it where? On YouTube, okay? We have different ideas what we think peculiar would be. This, Mom, you shine in that clip, by the way. This is an example of probably you would look at this and say, well, that's a little peculiar, right? It's a little odd. Yeah, it's peculiar. You might run the other way out of fear if you saw that guy walking toward you at night at a gas station, right? Okay, what about her? That's just painful, right? Lots of questions, all the questions. Here's another one. What about this guy? That is my brother. That's Seth. And, you know, he's been in our family for 10 years. He married my sister 10 years ago, and so we don't do in-laws, by the way. So when I say, I know it gets real confusing, you're trying to figure out who's married to who right now. That's my brother. And so when we go places as a family, we don't think about it. I mean, we don't really think about Seth's gauges anymore. You know, we don't, Sharon and Kim, you know what I'm talking about. You don't think about him and think, oh, man, here he is with all his tattoos and the gauges. But we go in public, and people are, and you're like, what are you looking at? My mom literally just about clawed somebody's eyes out once for the mumbling and looking and the whole thing, right? Because by most of normal, whatever that is, people's definitions, they would look at these guys and say, that's peculiar, right? That's weird. Well, the thing is, 1 Samuel 16 says that the Lord doesn't look at the things people look at. That people look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart, right? So what really makes my brother peculiar is definitely not the way he looks. The more you get to know him, you realize you don't know another 30-year-old as passionate about Jesus as this man, or who loves people this much, or who works this hard and has this kind of business integrity and ethic and all those things. That's what makes him peculiar, and that's what we want this series to be, is not just about you're weird. If you're coming to Movement Church, you go to the peculiar church. You know that, right? This is it. This is our reputation in this community. Oh, you go to Movement. Somebody literally just said to me the other day, I've heard a lot of good things about Movement. What does peculiar mean? Different from normal or usual. Different in character from others. And we're getting this from 1 Peter 2:9. It says, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a peculiar people, that you would show forth the praises of him who has called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Let's look at the definition of peculiar worked into that verse. But you're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, different from normal, different in character, that you would show forth the praises of him who's called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Here it is in the Message Bible. You are the ones chosen by God, chosen for the high calling of priestly work, chosen to be a holy people, God's instruments to do his work and speak out for him, to tell others others of the night and day difference he made for you, from nothing to something, from rejected to accepted. So if that sounds like you, you are peculiar. Everybody say, I'm peculiar. So what makes you peculiar? We're going to talk about three things today. Number one, I'm peculiar because according to 1 Peter 2, I am a royal priest. Now, I don't want you to think of priest as if, I know we have a lot of people that have a Catholic background. That I'm not talking about Catholic Church kind of priest. That's a man-made system. That has nothing to do with the priest I'm talking about, okay? I'm talking about back let me say this first. When Rod, this is one of his favorite verses, and years ago, I had a plaque made for his desk that says, Rod Windham, Royal Priest. And he had it on the front of his desk for years because I think he is absolutely the definition of a royal priest. And I'll read this to you and you'll understand why I'm saying that. But back in biblical times, Old Covenant church, if you want to call it that, the way that the temple and all of that stuff worked, synagogue, whatever, is that a priest was chosen. He was delicately chosen by God. There was lots of rituals and routines that he had to go through. And he was the mediator between God and man. It was one man. He was chosen in this community to be the one who mediated between God and man, okay? It's a pretty heavy responsibility, and it was a lot of work for him. It cost him a lot, okay? But his job was this, to make sacrifices on behalf of the people before the Lord, to speak for his people to the Father in prayer, to be a judge helping people settle disputes, bringing wisdom to conflicts, to speak blessings over people, to teach others the word of God, to keep a fire burning, on the altar so people could make their sacrifices and get forgiveness. Aren't we called to make sacrifices on behalf of people before the Lord? Aren't we called to sacrifice? Aren't we called to speak for his people to the Father in prayer? When somebody tells you something's going on in their life, isn't it our job to fall on our faces before the Lord for them and pray for them and help them carry this, right? Aren't we called to be a judge, to help, not to judge, to be a judge, to help people settle disputes, bringing wisdom to their conflicts? Shouldn't we be known for the wisdom that we have? Aren't we called to speak blessings, like Pastor Matt said, over people? Aren't we called to teach others the word of God? And aren't we called to keep the altar fire burning, to help people keep their relationship with God, the fire stoked in that relationship with God? So do you realize that all of those priestly duties, to quote Nacho Libre, my priestly duties, all of those priestly duties that one man had are now on all of us? We have great responsibility laying on us, but what freedom is it that I don't have to find the man that can mediate for me to the Father, right? I don't have to find him. His name was Jesus, and he found me. Amen. And that is over. But now the responsibilities that laid on that one man lay on us because we are a body, and these are our responsibilities. Notice that it didn't say in 1 Peter, if you're in ministry, these are your responsibilities. No, you are a royal priest, you. I'm not even a pastor. I wouldn't want your job for nothing. You're probably right, but you are a royal priest. You are called and chosen just as much as Rod, just as much as me, just as much as anyone who stands here on the stage. You are called to fulfill those duties, and you have been equipped to do it. You know, this being set apart isn't about us. We're not set apart because of anything we do, right? We're set apart because Ephesians 2, 8, 9 says, God saved you by his grace when you believed. And you can't take the credit for this. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we've done, so none of us can boast about it. So the minute I step into the thought process of thinking that I'm living in a way that makes me superior to someone else, I have stepped out of God's ability into my ability. And I have just taken righteousness and turned it into self-righteousness. And here's the spoiler alert. It never ends well. Ever. Let me tell you something. I said this to you a few weeks ago. Remember that there's the scripture that says our righteousness is as filthy rags. Remember that scripture? And I told you that literally what that's referring to are the menstrual cloths that women would use back in that time when it was their time of the month. And what does that mean? When someone is having her time of the month, we're all adults kind of, and here there's kids, but you get it, that when she was having her time of the month, that means I did not conceive last month, right? That means I was not able to produce life. I didn't produce life, whatever it was. So on your best day, on your most righteous day, your righteousness is nothing without his righteousness. Your righteousness on its own is a show of I can't produce life on my own. I can't. Okay? So that's freedom. That's freedom. Number two, we're going to get into this again. I'm peculiar because I'm different from normal. You ever looked around and said to your family, we're the weird ones? I was griping about something the other day to Lori, my sister, on the phone, just griping and griping, and I said, Lori, we are the weird ones. Apparently, this is normal. We're the weird ones. That's freedom, but that doesn't feel freeing, right? You know, Walker asked me the other day, he's got so much tact. He's so tactful. And he just says to me, Mom, why can't you just be like a normal mom? With so much angst in his voice, you know? I said, what does that even mean? He said, I don't know. Why don't you do normal mom things? What does that mean? And then it made me feel all self-conscious about my momming, right? But there's a whole lot of things that are normal in this world that I don't want anything to do with if it's normal. Am I right? You know, it's normal to be offended. It's normal to be hateful. It's normal to be disconnected from your family. It's normal to be married to your job. Those are normal. The only normal that I'm interested in is the normal that was provided for me under the finished work of Jesus. What he says is normal in heaven is the normal I want to live in on earth, right? I'm not interested in what culture says is normal. Here's the deal. I'm not interested in what my pediatrician says my kids should be normal. I know them, right? So one thing we have to understand as peculiar people is that there is a huge difference in righteousness and godliness, okay? We kind of lump all those words into one big thing, right? But they're not the same, and I'm going to tell you why. The principle of cause and effect is seen so clearly in our world. God made it this way, right? We sow, we reap, right? So cause and effect is obviously when two or more events occur in a way that one is a result of the other, right? So we're just going to do some examples of cause and effect. Cause would be it even hints that it's going to snow or ice. And the effect is we shut all the schools down in North Alabama, right? The cause would be Starbucks makes their red cups, their solid red cups, instead of having snowflakes on it. And the effect is religious people suddenly have a very vested interest in Starbucks and start boycotting it. Am I right? Okay, another cause would be Alabama goes to the national championship. The effect always is Alabama becomes the national champions. All right, we're the ushers. Where are actually the ushers? Yeah. That was an usher. Did you hear that? The cause would be child A looks at child B. The effect is World War III commences. Hey, do you know that one of your kids can breathe inappropriately and the other one will lose their mess about it? He's breathing loud on purpose, Mom. Walker looks at her and goes, So let's look at cause and effect from the word of God, okay? Cause was God loved the world. Effect was he gave his son. Cause was we were dying in sin. Effect is Christ made us a new creation. Cause was Christ became poor. Effect is we inherit his riches. Do you see? So here's the cause and effect I want to get to with righteousness and godliness. The cause is we have been made righteous because of Jesus. The effect is we have the power to live godly lives. So righteousness has been settled. You can't mess it up. You can't mess it up by what you do, what you think, what you punch somebody in the face, go to jail, whatever it is you do. You can't affect the righteousness of God. It is inside of you. It's who you are. Every cell of your body is righteous. You are righteous. We are called to live in godliness. We already are righteous, but our righteousness is supposed to show through godliness. Do you see what I'm saying? 2 Corinthians 5 says, God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so we might become the righteousness of God. It's not something we have. We are the righteousness of God. Romans 3:22 says, this righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. See, the goal is the more I walk in Christ, the more confident I am that I am righteous like he says I am. And I start making godly choices because I want to honor him, right? I don't want to throw shade on the righteousness of God. I want to honor it and put it at the highest pinnacle in my life, right? So the truth is, this is a diamond. Look at this picture. This is a diamond. Doesn't look like much, does it? And truthfully, probably something I would overlook if I was digging in a yard and found it. I'd be like, look at that weird rock. I probably should give that to one of my kids. Huge mistake, right? But in the hands of a jeweler who knows exactly the cut to make, exactly the process it needs to go through, exactly the polishing, it ends up looking like this. Oh, wow. Right? That is also a diamond. That first diamond is just as diamond as that diamond. But there's a process that it has to go through to show that it is a diamond. That is the righteousness of God and the godliness that we are supposed to walk in. You are as righteous as you'll ever be. But in the hands of the grace of God, a healthy church, a community of people who spur you on, the Word of God, studying the Word of God, all these cuts and polishes are being made in your life so that the world can see that you've been a diamond all along. Amen. Right? It doesn't make you more. A diamond can't get more of a diamond than what it is. But it's able to reflect who you really are, right? So if I asked you what are some things that are ungodly, you would be able to tell me, before you could lose that one breath you take to talk, 30 things you know that are ungodly. Racism is ungodly. Sexual abuse is ungodly. You know, all of the, we would know, right? We would know. Violence, ungodly. We would know. But what about looking at godliness of, this is just something I do that doesn't look like God? That hurts a little bit, doesn't it? So like this, what about when I respond to someone in anger? That's ungodly. Because the Bible says, be angry, go ahead and be angry, but sin not when you're angry, right? What about when I cut corners to get a job done? That's ungodly. Why? Because he spared no expense in sending Jesus. He went lavishly loving us, and we try to cut corners. That's not godly, right? This isn't condemnation. I'm just helping you see that these little choices that we make are reflecting our godliness, our righteousness, okay? Here's another one. How about when I look away hoping someone else will do it? No one washed the feet of the disciples, and Jesus got up and said, I will do it. What about when I'm choosing entertainment that is poisoning my marriage right under my nose? I could camp out here. Y'all know I could. But the thing is, like Job said, I've made a covenant with my eyes that I'm not going to watch this stuff because it's poisoning my marriage. If it's not God, if God would not sit down and watch it, why am I subjecting my marriage to it? Right? But it is freedom when I realize that I don't have to make all these choices because I'm trying to become more God-like, more righteous. I am righteous. I'm in right standing with him. But the more I understand what it cost him to give me this righteousness, the more I want to honor that gift. And I want to make choices that bring honor to his name, right? Look at this again. You're a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, different from normal. Different in character. I like this part. Privately owned. That you would show forth the praises of him who's called you out of darkness into his marvelous light. Righteousness is the cause. Godliness is the effect. Because I'm righteous, I can live godly. Because I'm righteous, I can love when I don't want to. Because I'm righteous, I can forgive. Because I'm righteous, I'm in the world, but I'm not of it. Right? Because I'm righteous, I don't have to lower my standards, but I'm called to a higher standard of living. So first, I have to check the condition of my heart. Am I reflecting godliness? Well, let's look. Let me check the condition of my heart. You're going to hear this verse 8 million times if you come to church here long. Proverbs 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do comes from it. Ezekiel 36:26 says, I will give you a new heart and I will put a new spirit in you. I will take out your stony, stubborn heart and give you a tender, responsive heart. Do you ever had a callus? It's because there's friction happening, right? Look, you had at one time a tender, open, receptive heart. You were a child once. You were a young adult once. Maybe it was in your young adult years, and you know, the years where your heart was so open and sensitive, and you remember that God used to speak to you and used to feel so close to him. But then, you know what we do? We start rubbing against stuff that doesn't belong to us. We start making choices that we should not be making. We start participating in things we shouldn't participate. And then we get frustrated because this isn't working. So my heart starts callousing. Because there's a friction happening that should not be happening, right? You know, is my heart calloused? Here's a little checkup. Am I desensitized to the culture or the world around me? Has it been a long time since I felt him move or heard his voice? I don't mean like audibly. I mean like those little nudges you used to know that were him. Is my heart calloused? Am I slower to responding to the needs of others than I was before? Oof, that's tough. Is my heart calloused? Am I using the freedom I have in Christ to live as an excuse to live however I want? you come around here long, and then you go tell, like, especially religious people in your family that you're going to movement church, and they've heard anything about our message, they will almost always say, oh, that's that church that only preaches God is good. Oh, okay, that's cool. You go to that church, it's like a cotton candy church. Like, all they do is just talk about goodness of God, the goodness of God, the goodness. Yeah, we do, because we believe the goodness of God is what brings us to repentance. That's why. But here's the deal. You're going to hear us say, guys, you can live, you can do whatever you want. You can go out of here and wreck your marriage. You can go out of here and participate in whatever you want to participate in. It does not affect the righteousness that God has already given you. But what? The wages of sin is death. It will destroy your life. There will be consequences, but it does not affect your righteousness. And religious people hate that. They hate it because it takes the power and the control away from that religion.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I can't control you and manipulate you into looking like God anymore. It's because I have to work out my own salvation here. I have to work it out. I have to let God do his work inside of my heart, right? But this message we teach is not a license for you to go and do whatever you want. It's not, oh, God loves me no matter what. Guys, good news. Here we go. Light it up, right? No, because listen, Ephesians 5 says, it is absolutely clear that God has called you to live a free life. Just make sure you don't use this freedom as an excuse to do whatever you want and destroy your freedom. Rather, use your freedom to serve one another in love. That's how freedom grows. 1 Corinthians says, just because something is technically legal doesn't mean it's spiritually appropriate. If I went around doing whatever I thought I could get by with, I'd be a slave to my whims. Oh, that's good. Yeah. Romans 12:2 says, don't become so well adjusted to your culture that you fit in without thinking. Instead, fix your attention on God. You'll be changed from the inside out. Readily recognize what he wants from you and quickly respond to it, unlike the culture around you, always dragging you down to its level of immaturity. God brings out the best in you, develops well-formed maturity in you. So see, if you're saying things like, well, see, Pastor Jill said, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. It means I can do whatever I want. Can't mess it up. She said, I'm going to do whatever I want. You still don't understand that you're righteous. Listen to me. Righteousness always calls you higher. Always. When I grab it, I want to go higher. Not so I can stand over people and talk down to them, but so I can pull them up and say, there's a higher standard here. There's a higher way of living here that we don't have to be down here in the middle, right? Ephesians 5:26 says, Christ's love makes the church whole. His words evoke her beauty. Everything he does and says is designed to bring out the best in her, dressing her in dazzling white silk, radiant with holiness. The more I walk with him, the more my heart is going to go, Jesus, I want to look just like you. I want to love like you. I want to talk like you. The relationship that he has with me was not designed to make me do anything. It should be this romance that's just pulling this love out of me, these godly decisions out of me. Not that I always want to do it. I don't want to do it sometimes. Sometimes you just want to throw something at somebody's head. That's the truth. No better if their pastor tells you he don't want to do that, he is lying. Because we all do. But in the garden, Jesus had his own will, right? That he wanted to do something different here. God, if this is the moment, I mean, I need you to give me another plan. And then he brought it back together and said, this isn't about what I want. This is about what you want. I want what you want right here, right? It doesn't always feel good. You know, talking about Christ's love making the church whole and his words evoking her beauty, I can be in the worst mood ever. I mean, you know, if your kids have a love language of touch, those days are real long when they're little. You know what I'm saying? And you just want to kind of peel your skin off. Or Google, how can I remove my arms at the end of the day? Right? I mean, like this, I'm tired of being touched, or I'm irritated, or the laundry's piled up, and y'all have fought all day, and, you know, y'all have made me lose my mind up in here, that kind of stuff. But I'm going to tell you this. One man knows exactly what to do, what to say, how to come up right behind me and in my ear, say exactly what I need to hear at that moment, and my whole mood changes. Bow, 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 bow. You know what I'm saying? I can promise you that he knows not to come up and say, the dishes are in the sink, just letting you know, I'm gonna go outside. That is not what's gonna evoke beauty from me at the end of a long day. But he does know what it is that's going to evoke beauty for me. Let me tell you something. We're not listening We're not listening to what the Lord is. He is trying to romance you. He's trying to change your heart. He's trying to speak to you through the word of God, through people, through little nudges in your heart. And we're going, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. I made up my mind. I'm going to have a bad attitude, you know, right? But he by nature, this relationship that you have with him is cause and effect, that he should be able to walk up behind you and say, hey, I've got this. I see you. Let me handle it. No, you don't. You ain't been. Where have you been, right? Let him evoke that beauty from you. Let him evoke that love from you. Rod knows how. You know, I've told you this 1,000 times, that God is not interested in changing your behavior. He is interested in changing your heart. It's completely different. Number 3, last one. I'm peculiar because I speak for God. That's a pretty bold thing to say. Of, I represent the God of the universe in this conversation. I speak for him. 2 Corinthians says, the old life is gone, chapter 5. Look, a new life burgeons. Look at it. All of this comes from God, who settled the relationship between us and him and then called us to settle our relationships with each other. God put the world square with himself through the Messiah, giving the world a fresh start by offering forgiveness of sin. Listen, God has given us the task of telling everyone what he's doing. We are Christ's representatives. God uses us to persuade men and women to drop their differences and enter into God's work of making things right between them. We're speaking for Christ himself now. Become friends with God. He's already become a friend with you. If I'm going to speak for him, I better know what he says. There are some people that speak for God that need to keep their mouths closed. I'm just going to go ahead and say that right now. You know what I'm talking about. I'm not saying that God never disciplines us. He never confronts us. There's sometimes, and there's some people in this room that will say, Jill, back up. Tracy's one of them. Looking at her right now. You're being nosy. Turn around. I mean, she literally said to me not long ago, hey, you're being nosy. Go on. And then she goes, but I love you. He always says something like that behind you. But you need those people in your life, right? And God speaks to us that way of sometimes, hey, that was rude. Go back and fix that, right? But if I'm not listening, I'm not going to hear him. Am I right? And I have to know what he's going to say if I'm going to speak for him. See, there's very few things you could ask of me, ask of Rod in his absence, that I could not answer. I'm not saying that arrogantly. That's how marriage should be after 21 years, right? You should be able to come to me and say, hey, Rod's not here, but I wanted to know, what do you think he would feel about blah, blah, blah? And I should be able to say, oh, he would do blah, 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 because I know him. It's more than I just know his favorite thing to drink or what he likes to watch on TV. I know his heart, but I had to study it and walk beside him and be in this intimate relationship with him day in and day out to be able to speak for Rod. Am I right? So if I'm going to speak for God, I better know what he's going to say. Right. That's an honor. It's a privilege to be able to speak for the king of the universe. Amen. I'm not speaking for the president. I'm not speaking for a government official. I'm speaking for God. You know, my favorite appointment Jesus ever had is the woman at the well, and I could talk about it all day, but he had been, you know, talking and ministering to people, and he said, I got to get to Galilee, but then he said, I need to go through Samaria. I know that there's something, and he actually said, I need to go through Samaria. There's a reason I've got to go through there. We don't know if Jesus knew what his appointment was or if just the Holy Spirit was saying, you got to go through Samaria today. Whatever reason, he knew. He gets there to the well. Here's the woman. You know, women would carry water back and forth to their homes, and they would do it in the morning or in the evening because it was so hot, and these are so heavy and laborious, it was hard for them to do it in the middle of the day. Well, this woman had a real sketchy past, so we believe that she was drawing this water in the middle of the day, in the hottest part of the day, because no one's out there right then. She could avoid all the faces she didn't want to see. She could hide. She could get the water. Surprise, you're not hiding from him, right? So he goes, and he says, hey, you know, I'm thirsty. Give me some water. And she says, you're a Jew. I'm a Samaritan. Do you not know anything? Like, are you new here? You don't know how things work. We don't talk to each other. And he said, why don't you go get your husband? And she said, I don't have a husband. And he said, I know. You've had 5. And the man you're living with right now is not your husband. She's like, hold on, huh? Who said that? How did you know that? Now she's intrigued, because we like women, we like to know, where did you get your information, right? Did you talk to Jennifer? Yeah. But basically, she was an emotional leper. She was thrown out because she had a very sexually impure track record here. You following me? And divorce was a whole other ballgame back then, you guys. So he's talking to her and he starts telling her, look, there's going to be a new day coming. The Jews and Samaritans are not going to be labeled anymore. This is going to be a brand new kingdom and, you know, everything's going to change. And she said, well, I guess when the Messiah gets here, he'll teach us how all this is going to look. And he said, I am he. And she set her pot down, right? And then, just then the disciples came back. Look at this. They were shocked. They couldn't believe he was talking with that kind of woman. I love messy Jesus. No one said what they were all thinking, but their faces showed it. And the woman took the hint and left, and in her confusion, left her water pot. The very reason she came there, her purpose has changed. You following me? Back in the village, she told the people, come see a man who knew all the things I did, who knows me inside and out. Do you think this could be the Messiah? And they came to see for themselves. And in the meantime, the disciples pressed him, Rabbi, eat. Aren't you going to eat? And then he told them, I have food to eat that you know nothing about. And the disciples were puzzled. Who could have brought him food? Because, you know, Jesus also had this little twitch that he spoke in parables all the time, and nobody ever knew if he was literal or not. And then Jesus said, the food that keeps me going is that I do the will of the one who sent me, finishing the work he started. As you look around right now, wouldn't you say it's about 4 months until harvest? They probably were like, yeah, it's about right, according to the calendar. Well, I'm telling you to open your eyes and look at what's right in front of us. The Samaritan fields are ripe. It's harvest time. In the original, it says the fields are white with harvest. So scholars believe that back then in this village in Samaria, that workers, plain clothes, minimum wage, hard-working manual labor workers had white linen robes, white uniforms, for lack of a better term, that they wore to identify that they were working hard. They're hard workers. These are the guys who are building. These are the movers and the shakers and the hard workers. And so this woman takes off running to town as fast as she can, right? And she's yelling to these men. How many of them has she slept with? We don't even know. How many husbands, how many wives have said, you don't ever look at her again? You know what I'm saying? This is her reputation. She's at the well in the middle of the day, y'all. This is a big deal. And she's yelling, you guys, come. He knew everything that I've ever done. Do you think this could be the Messiah? And it says they started coming, right? Well, Jesus all of a sudden looks. He's not interested in eating food in this moment. He looks and he says, look, the fields are white. Scholars believe that these men left everything in the middle of the day and are coming as streams of people are coming, these white-robed, hard-working men that probably have been part of her failure and her demise. All these men coming through the fields, and Jesus literally said, look, these fields are white with harvest. This is why we're here. This is why we had to go through Samaria today, because we had an appointment with this white harvest, right? But listen to this. Let's go before the story for a minute. In John 4, it says, Jesus realized that the Pharisees, this is before he went to Samaria, okay? Jesus realized the Pharisees were keeping count of the baptisms that he and John performed. Although the disciples, not Jesus, did the baptizing. They had posted the score that Jesus was ahead, turning him and John into rivals in the eyes of the people, so that Jesus left the Judean countryside and went back to Galilee. This is what comparison does. Let me tell you what it does. It divides, it destroys, and it distracts you from your purpose. Listen to me. If Jesus had let the squabbling and the rhetoric, John's done more. Jesus isn't as awesome as he thinks he is. John has baptized 12 just in that one town. Well, yeah, well, shut up, man. You don't even know. Jesus baptized 24 people in Bethlehem, right? This is what's actually happening. If Jesus had let the squabbling get to him, the woman at the well, and a whole village would have paid the price for it. If Jesus had let insecurity about what he was called to do versus what John was called to do take root in his heart, his motives would have been affected, and he might have bypassed Samaria altogether. If Jesus had dwelled on the content matter of jealous people's conversations, he would have focused on their words instead of the Father's words that he was supposed to speak at that moment. If Jesus had turned what they were saying into his purpose, he would have focused on baptizing instead of reaching. If Jesus kept score, he wouldn't have kept focus. If Jesus had listened to emotions, he wouldn't have heard truth. But instead, Jesus knew this conversation is toxic. And he turned from the chatter and turned toward his purpose, which was in Samaria. You know what makes you peculiar? You have a purpose that's greater than the chattering you're hearing. A purpose that's greater than the comparison game, women, that we play with each other. Your purpose is greater than who is doing what, and that's not fair, and he does a better job than me. You've been called to speak for heaven. to tell the world what God's heart is toward this. He's somewhere in Madison or Huntsville or wherever they're watching this. There is a well. And at that well, there is a man or a woman or a teenager or a child who is waiting for you to pass by. That well is going to look like a cash register or a gas pump or a locker in a hallway. And they will be looking for you, but they don't know it. And they will be the one that has resolved, this is as good as it's ever going to get. She puts on a good front, or he may be bitter and distant. Listen to me, you will have to go out of your way to reach them. But what I need you to know is that behind that person, behind that man, behind that woman, behind that child, is a village that is waiting for change. There is a family behind that person. There is a generation behind that person. A harvest is white, and it's waiting for you to tell that person at the gas station what you need to tell them. Yeah. It's not your job to change the community. You're peculiar. You're the odd one out, but so are they. Studies show that 98% of Christ followers never personally lead another person to Christ in their lifetime. Wow. 98%. The wells of this world are crowded with people waiting, and we elect not to be peculiar, not to be different from anybody else. Evangelizing isn't your thing. Well, let's go back to the well. Jesus said the most profound thing, a technique, a truth that's not taught in seminary school, that's only caught from the heart of God. Jesus said to her, if you knew the water I provide, you'd ask me for a drink and you'd never thirst again. It reminds me that there was a young salesman who was disappointed at losing a big sale. And when he talked to his manager, he said, I guess it just proves you can lead a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. The manager replied, son, take my advice. Your job is not to make them drink. Your job is to make them thirsty. Jesus didn't solve the woman's problems. He just made her thirsty for hope. Make them thirsty, you peculiar person. Make them want, just by watching you, the water you're drinking. You are their royal priest, whether you like it or not. You're their living hope. You're their advocate, their messenger. You are the sneak peek into the Father's heart for them. You are a peculiar child of a peculiar God, and he has set you apart to do peculiar things. Do them. Let me pray for you. Holy Spirit, I know, like I know my name, you want to do something different in North Alabama this year. I know, like I know my name, you want to use Movement Church. Lord, we already have the stigma attached to us of the weird church. We're okay with that. Because you're a pretty weird God. You've done some pretty weird things. So we want to follow you. We want to be peculiar. We want to be different from the norm. Not just to be different. Not for the sake of being different, but because I'm sick of the world's normal. I'm sick of just doing cookie-cutter, systemic church. We want to be a church that shakes the generations. Lord, where are our wells? At gas stations, in lines at Publix, when we're at the DMV, wherever we are, show us the woman that you want us to go out of the way for. And then, Lord, let us see a glimpse of the harvest that's coming behind her. Let us see the people that are working hard and struggling every day to put food on the table. Those are the ones we want. We want the ones who everyone has said, go to Movement Church. I don't know what else to tell you. You'll fit in over there. Bring them here, Lord. Holy Spirit, we say yes to that mission. We say yes. We'll do it. Lord, if we're going to live like fools, we want to do it for you. And I thank you that on the other side of the encounter at our well, there is a harvest waiting on you. We will reap it for you. We will bring them in here. We will love on them. We will show them what you say about them. We'll show them realness. We'll show them grace. Show us our wells, Lord. If you're here today and you haven't asked Jesus to be your Savior, we want to end this service with that opportunity because it's the most important decision you'll ever make in your life. Let's all pray this together. Let's say, Jesus, I believe you came into this world. You lived a sinless life. You took my sin. You took my judgment. My past is gone. My future is spotless. I call you my Lord.